Yes.
So
we're sitting
start.
Here with Rachel Frere.
Hello.
Who's visiting us for a week from London. And 2 days ago she gave a talk in our Shop Talk series about how do we know what we want. Because Rachel is a
specialist in knowing what people want. Or making people's want come too.
Yes. So, yeah, that's cool.
Yeah. So how did you get so good at knowing what people want?
Because I work for so many different kinds of people. So I work as a designer, making my own clothes, and I work directly with clients. I work for other fashion designers, interpreting their vision, which has to be very practical, and solving problems to make the samples, to create the collections. And then I work for costume designers, creating fantastical things. And so all these different experiences of how you interact with people, yeah, they're all slightly different, but they all kind of cross over and inform each other.
Mm-hmm. And so is it that people then come to you and they already know what you want? Or is it more of a process of to get you?
Every person's different. So some people will come and they'll have seen a picture and they'll want something based on something very, very definite, and then sometimes people come with more of an idea. Or sometimes people come and say, I want you to make something that of your style, but just make me look cool, or make me look thin, or make me look imposing, and then you have to work out what that is.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes you're drawing a drawing completely from your head, sometimes they're bringing you an image and you're interpreting the image.
I like that they actually come and say, like, make me look imposing.
Mm-hmm.
And then
yeah.
They just know from your previous work that you have the capability to achieve that.
Yeah, and that's why you have, that's kind of essentially why I make fashion collections. I'm not making it to sell and to kind of like impart my idea of how people should look. I'm doing it to show like what's inside my head, and then people can take that and then they can either take one of those pieces or they can make it their own.
Mm-hmm.
And preferably they're going to make it their own.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
And that leads in nicely to your current collection.
Yes.
Which is also a way of showing what you are. We're interested in of how different ways of sharing the designs that you do.
Yes. So one of the hardest things is getting people to commission. So people are kind of intimidated by it. So people kind of know what they want, but often people need to be given options. So my idea is that I'm making a collection of jumpsuits, and they are based on the idea that you should be able to have a uniform so you don't have to think too much about what you wear. And it should be super practical, and it should also look cool. And it needs to cater for everyone. So it's going to be unisex, it's going to be modular, and you can pick a base and then you can customize it with different features that suit you. And it's going to be offered as a standard garment that you can buy that's like the standard sort of simple fashion sort of shell that looks cool. But, and then there'll be like a bespoke version that'll be very well made and very practical and very hardy. And then you can also have the pattern for free. So you can download the pattern and you can have someone else make it. And you just have to attribute where it came from.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so open source pattern, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea is that these things should be universal. So I don't really own it. A lot of the time when you design, people get this idea that like, it's mine, I made this, and it's like, well, it was inspired by someone,
mm-hmm.
and it was inspired by the world around you, and actually, how can you really own it? Like, who really owns it? Like, at the end of the day, we offer a service, and we make things for people, and that's the value. We've kind of lost the idea of that as that being the value. It's all like, I have this amazing idea and I'm going to keep hold of it. And it's like, actually, those ideas should be shared.
Yeah. So I imagine I go to your website then and I see these examples of these jumpsuits and I say, I want one of those too. And then I have these options. One, I can download the patterns and make them myself. And through doing that, I already get a better sense of like what work would be involved. I get a sense that, oh, actually, I can't do this. Or this is going to take me a month of figuring it out. So that then if I do decide to order it from you or from another tailor who lives in Berlin, say, I have a better sense of what work is going into making the garment.
And understanding it, I think that's quite important. I don't think we understand where our clothes come from anymore.
Mm.
So yeah, it'd be really cool if somebody who had an interest, like a hobby, an interest in sewing, downloaded the pattern, made their own version and went, okay, this is great, and now I know what I want it to be. And then they went to somebody and had it made perfectly in a way that they felt was more professional or maybe more looked the way they wanted it to look.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you're letting people modify your design too.
Yes. Yeah. So I would love if people downloaded the pattern,
mm-hmm.
modified the pattern, and then uploaded the results.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. and then other people could use that. So mm-hmm. the idea currently for the free pattern is that people can download it for free, mm-hmm. and they don't have to pay anything, but they're asked for a donation, and the only thing they have to do is to sort of say where it's come from. So if someone wants to make it, pretend that it was theirs and resell it, then that would be kind of not cool.
Mm-hmm. So it's like the share alike.
Exactly. Yeah. It's a Creative Commons share alike, mm-hmm. Non-commercial. Mm-hmm.
And should a person also upload, is it obligatory that they would let you know what they have done with it, or that's optional?
Well, I don't think you can control that, so if it's encouraged, that's really nice. Mm-hmm. I mean, maybe someone would use it but already in modified pattern, so then they'd be inclined to upload their own. Mm-hmm. Well, often what you find is that once you give people something to react to, then they get more involved. So someone might go, oh, actually, I think that those packets of rubbish are too big, so I make smaller ones, and mine's better. Mm-hmm. You know, and the dialogue can start. And so mm-hmm. I think you see it with knitting websites, where this happens and people modify mm-hmm. patterns. Mm-hmm. And so hopefully that would happen. I think that trying to make the format clear and easy is going to be the biggest challenge, because it's like, how do you then re-upload a pattern, because patterns are so big. Mm-hmm. So
yeah.
That's the biggest
thing. Something that should be
challenge.
So simple mm-hmm. turns out to be the
Yeah, maybe
challenge.
It would be just that, you know, you could, rather than trying to scan it so that it's a absolute perfect pattern that you can just download, which is what I want to present, mm-hmm. people could just stick it to the wall and take a picture, and mm-hmm. then you could just look at the comparison of like the thumbnail, and then you could see the modifications that have been made. Mm-hmm. So even if they just did that, it would be amazing.
Yeah, and so Mika and I are kind of now in the business of making custom technology, mm-hmm. and so in a sense we're trying to also create this collection to show what's possible. And you're here working on your jumpsuit and wanting it to be open so that other people can make it, and we've decided we actually would like to make a version of your collection for you,
which is amazing. So yeah, this is totally out different from what normally happens, because normally I'm making clothes for other people. So now for me to get to be the person that receives the first one is kind of amazing. As a collaboration, it's amazing. Mm. So yeah, to decide what I want was not something that I normally do.
Yeah, it was not so easy to get what you want from you, actually.
Yeah,
it took a while. Yeah,
it's an interesting process. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think I default to things that are very super practical. And so it's easy to lose the kind of lyrical side of it. So when I make things myself, I'm storytelling, and I'm putting these stories into things, but when actually it turns around on me, I want things that are super practical and not necessarily mm-hmm. as inspired. And it's kind of interesting, because that's how I split up what I do, like on the back end of it, like behind the camera, I'm being super practical mm-hmm. and, you know, not really thinking about these things, and then because I put all of my inspiration into my work. So when you suddenly turn it around and say, what do you want? I'm like, I don't know.
Yeah, I wanted to hear like a nipple jumpsuit suit or something.
You could put nipples in it, and then you put sensors in them so that they you look like a
okay, we can do this. So what are we making then?
Yeah, so you stuck with something practical.
Yes.
And you were also inspired by other work that you saw.
The bodysuit is a project that I'm working on that has a garment that gives haptic feedback. So to take you out of a screen and to allow you to physically map sensations onto your body. And one of the inspirations was the North Belt, which constantly tells you which way is north. And so I really like the idea of having something like this in a jumpsuit that meant that I didn't have to use maps on my phone. So it takes away the power of one function of my phone. So when I first came here, I realised that I don't have the same sense of direction that I used to. I remember mm-hmm. coming to Berlin previously, and I'd very quickly be able to figure out my orientation, but I don't have that sense anymore. It's not developed anymore, because now I've just let that fall aside because I have Google Maps.
Yeah,
so
because we're biking to the studio every day, and every time Rachel asks where it's north.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Did we go north now?
Yeah. That's true.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I think that would be, that'd be really cool. And then also something that's kind of built into it. I love the idea of having something that's built into it and experiencing it all the time, because I think a lot of the time when you have anything that's, when you think about wearables and developing wearables, a lot of them feel like they're quite special garments, and you would not necessarily wear it all the time. Mm-hmm. So to put something into the belt of a jumpsuit that it's with you at all times, mm-hmm. I think is a really nice mm-hmm. idea for me. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you guys can do it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And we have been doing it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we kind of set on the North Belt integrated in the waistband of the jumpsuit, and now we've been just trying to figure out how can we, because part of the waistband is elastic, that's maybe one of the biggest challenges, mm-hmm. is how to have all the conductors go to the motors and be and scrunched up, and also I think the combining with the aesthetics too.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah, and then also the, a lot of times what we talked was the interaction with it, or like how it behaves, because North Belt always tells you North, where's the vibration motor, and then we said, okay, maybe all the time is too much, there's some ways to, for it to tell you when, where the North is, or not, and should it be belt or not belt,
mm-hmm.
so then the easiest way is to test it, mm-hmm. and then we made this test version, tried it out, and that is...
Yeah, well, yeah, so, yeah, we did, we couldn't do a Wizard of Oz so easily, which is kind of to simulate the technology, but it was quick for Mika to make up this belt with 8 vibration motors along it, and then Rachel wore it, and we played around with a bit of different, like, speeds of vibration, breaking around.
I don't know if you can see the video, but so, and then, yeah, 8 different motors. And yeah, what did you think when you tried it?
It was really interesting to just to do a test with to make sure the motors were working, and just having the buzz run around the waist, and it was really calming. I was really surprised. It was quite relaxing to have this sort of this little buzz running around my waist. So it feels like it could even have extra function.
Mm-hmm.
So it could be a North Belt, and I like the idea of jumping to activate it because mm-hmm. it's a jumpsuit. To turn it on and off, and it's really intentional, but then also that it can have another setting and do other things as well, because actually once you have this system that's kind of like rebalanced in the garment, then yeah, it can have different applications.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I also really like the idea that it's a wake-up call, so I love the idea that if I sit still for too long, it knows, and then it will buzz me back into action just to remind me to get up and do something. So, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, maybe it could run around to let you know that it can time to go out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like your cat wanting you to open the door, like purring around.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Purring, yeah, that's a perfect way to describe it.
Mm-hmm.
So one of the next prototypes we made was this is the waistband that would be gathered in the back, and the orange stripes are copper fabric, and every quarter there'll be a slit for a motor that we've mounted on a little board to insert into the band. It's so tight now I'm not going to get it out. But we
I
think
was worried
this
that it
might
fit well enough, but
yeah.
Now it fits really well.
Yeah. Yeah, and the bunch is quite okay. This
mm-hmm.
gathering works quite well.
I think visually it's really nice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I love the fact that this design is so prominent. So the first jumpsuit that I'm making is the block, which is the shape basis for the whole collection. And the first jumpsuit that I'm going to make to test will have this integrated into it,
mm-hmm.
into the block. So it's got this kind of stretch feature in it, but it also means that the jumpsuit's going to be super plain. So everything will be really clean lines. It won't have like lots of pockets on it. It will just be like really simple, really neat. And the whole focus is on this belt,
mm-hmm.
which is really decorative, but it's also completely functional.
Mm-hmm.
Which is, yeah, kind of what a jumpsuit does. It's like, mm-hmm. they have these pockets all over them, and there's this like huge amount that feels like decoration,
mm-hmm.
But every single part of it has a function, because it's a functional pocket, so it's very much in keeping with the idea of a jumpsuit as well,
mm-hmm.
which I think is really nice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so we have tonight and tomorrow left to finish this jumpsuit.
Tomorrow was supposed to be a day off.
Yeah, so
yeah,
we have 12
yeah.
hours left.
Yeah, let's see how far we go. But I think main...
To finish the
waistband.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
also some aesthetic and design questions already answered, tested here.
Mm-hmm.
So. You guys work really quickly, which is quite amazing to watch. It's like, to go through this, yeah. But to go through this amount of kind of thinking, like, there's so much that happens so quickly, like, you sort of turned around for like half an hour and you made this, and soldered it, and put all the stitching in, like, it's quite an amazing thing to see.
Mm.
And then just to suddenly go from the prototype into, I mean, effectively, this is the design, like, what, you know, resolving how the connections are made is actually a really complicated thing. And it's been really nice because you guys are doing this part and then I'm doing the pattern cutting part, and so we can talk between us to resolve different things about how things connect and how the materials act and react to each other. And it's just a really nice process.
Yeah.
And we both bringing different skills together, and the point where they meet is the point where all the problems get solved.
Yeah. And also some of these exciting physical questions, like this one, it's quite a thick felt or like wool, and how do I do the edges? And I was just doing it like the way I know, and then you told me like you can just do it halfway,
sure,
and
cut
it, yeah. And it looks, it's really nice. And all these like, you know, textile tricks or fashion tricks that you bring in, it's also really nice for this project.
Well, this is it. I think if you do anything like this, you need people on both sides of the conversation. So often it's like wearables don't feel very practical, or people are trying to put electronics into clothing and it just doesn't feel like they know what the possibilities are. So finding like, the right balance, I think, is really it's really cool.
Yeah.
And like, as having this as the first piece for the collection, like I need to go and like basically not sleep now for a month to get this done. And so like having the starting point be a beautiful, inspirational piece is kind of amazing. So when we shoot like the preview shot, will be like a press shot, and that's what this first piece will be. It'll be like trying to get the patterns ready and doing a press shot so that you can you have this vision of what it is, and to have that as the first image is really exciting. So this is my motivation.
And for us, I think it's great because it's one of the first commissions that we're kind of realizing in our shop, which is all about making tailor-made wearable technology for anyone who walks through the door. And this, so you're open sourcing your passion anyway, and of course we will also be open sourcing the technology.
And then if people want to order pieces from the collection that have integrated electronics, then they're going to come to you guys and come to the page. But they have to visit Berlin, so.
Business partner then.
Huh?
We are like a business partner.
We're business partners.
Oh.
We're welcome to Fashion Week. It's gonna be crazy.
Okay, should we stop?